Today class we are going to talk about mitral regurgitation. That is, if you see this diagram, this is the LV, this is the left atrium, the anterior mitral leaflet and the posterior mitral leaflet. In the mitral regurgitation, what happens during the systole, the blood, instead of going towards the aorta, goes towards back towards the left atrium. So the blood flows back to the left ventricle, to the left atrium during the mitral regurgitation. That is what the problem is. So what do you get it? Mechanism. So you get what type of murmur you get? In any case of systolic murmur, that is because it occurs during the phase of systole when the LV contract blood is going over to the left atrium, there are six subheads under which you describe a murmur. One is the grade of the murmur. Normally the systolic murmurs are graded from 1 to 6. For practical purposes, if the trill is there, we consider it a grade 4. If the trill is not there, grade 3. If you are able to hear a murmur without a trill, it becomes grade 3. If you got a trill, it becomes grade 4. So, grade of the murmur and what phase of the cardiac cycle. So, in the case of mitral regurgitation, the murmur is holosystolic. There are pansystolic. Why is it pansystolic? If you see the pressure difference between the LV and the LA, LA is the pressure is around 10 millimeter mercury, the LV pressure in the systole is around 8, 1, 8, 20. So there is a pressure gradient throughout the systole. So entire blood from the, during the entire phase of the cardiac systole, the blood goes back from the LV to the LA because of the valvular dysfunction. So the murmur in the case of mitral regurgitation is usually a pansystolic murmur. And it ends with the closure of the valve, that is what the aortic end, the end of the systole. Okay, so we have got a pansystolic murmur, grade depending upon the whether the trill is there or not. The third is the pitch. Pitch is usually the high pitched sound. So it's a high pitched sound. So you can hear better with the diaphragm of the stethoscope. Where you hear it best? It hear the murmur best at the apex, with a breath held in expiration. So any left side murmur, they increase the severity during the expiration. And important aspect of the mitral regurgitation murmur is the radiation. Normally, it is a pansystolic murmur radiating to axilla and back. Why axilla and back? The radiation depends upon the which leaflet is involved. If the anterior mitral leaflet is involved, the jet is directed posterior. So you find out the murmur radiating to axilla and back. Whereas if the posterior mitral leaflet is involved, the radiation is towards the base of the heart. You can hear in the second intercostal space. So there is a basic difference. The radiation of the MR murmur depending upon the which mitral leaflet is involved. Commonly it involves the anterior mitral leaflet. That's why we say that the murmur is radiating to axilla and back. So you have got heard about the murmur, which phase of the cardiac cycle and where it radiates. Second thing is that what happens to second sound? The second sound can be split. In case of a severe mitral regurgitation, what happens? In the case of a severe mitral regurgitation, the blood, instead of going back from the left ventricle to the aorta, goes back towards the left atrium. So hardly any blood goes towards the aorta. So the aortic valve closes early than expected, leading to a wide split due to that is the A2, and because the wide split because the A2 is occurring early, because entire blood from the LV goes to the left atrium, hardly any blood goes towards the aorta. So the aortic valve closes early, leading to early A2, normal P2, leading to wide second heart sound. In case of a severe mitral regurgitation, what happens in the early part of the in severe mitral regurgitation, there may be additional sound, the S3, because the large volume of blood in the left atrium, first during the systole, the blood from the left ventricle has come to the left atrium, and during the systole, the LA is relaxing, it is also receiving blood from the pulmonary veins. So the larger blood accumulates in the left atrium. The entire blood after the opening of the mitral leaflet comes to the third, causing the third heart sound. So the third heart sound in the setting of a mitral regurgitation indicates the severity. Okay, that is how the mitral regurgitation murmur is produced. Now, what are the causes? The common cause is in our setting, it is the rheumatic heart disease, or it can be due to infective endocarditis or connective tissue disorders where the valve may be involved. With the valve normal causing MR, it typically occurs in the case of a dilated cardiomyopathy where there is an annular dilatation leading to mitral regurgitation. So, how to assess the severity of the mitral regurgitation? The severity always depending upon the first is the symptomatology, whether the patient is symptomatic or not. If the symptomatic, then it is usually one of the indicators of the severity. Third, second is a pansystolic murmur, because irrespective of severity, pansystolic, the presence of S3 is an indication of the severity of mitral regurgitation. The widely split second zone, the wide split is because early occurring of the A2 with a normal P2, that is leads to wide splitting of second heart zone, that is also one indication of the severity. And fourth is the clinical examination, where you find the LV enlargement. You can find the left ventricular apex in the 6 intercostal space. So this is one of the indications of the severity of the mitral regurgitation. Now the difference is acute versus chronic. That is very important to understand what is the difference between acute versus chronic MR. What happens in the case of acute MR, say in the case of somebody has developed a myocardial infarction as a papillary muscle rupture, what will happen? It is causes to acute MR. In the setting of an acute MR, the LA is not prepared to receive the blood from the LV during the system. That is what happening? It is suddenly has occurred. So the LA is not prepared. So what will happen? If the blood goes in the early part of the systole, there is rapid equalization of pressures in the LA and LV, unlike chronic MR where the LA is dilated, so it is ready to accept the blood from the left ventricle throughout the system. But in acute MR, LA is normal size, it is not prepared for the to receive the blood. Suddenly it has occurred. So the LA, there is equalization of pressure, so there may not be a holosystolic murmur. Instead, there may be a ejection systolic murmur in case of acute MR, because there is rapid equalization of pressures in the LA and LV in a case of an acute MR. And patients tends to be more symptomatic in acute MR, because since LA is not dilated, entire blood goes back to the pulmonary vein causing the pulmonary edema. So in an acute MR, there may be an ejection systolic murmur. Again, the radiation depending upon the which leaflet is involved. If the anterior mitral leaflet is involved, it radiates to the back, and the posterior mitral leaflet is involved, the murmur radiates towards the base of the heart. You can hear in the left second intercostal space. What happens? So remember this, even in MR you can have a ejection systolic movement. In acute and chronic, what are the other thing? Then the LV enlargement. LV enlargement doesn't occur in the setting of a acute MR. It only occurs in the setting of a chronic MR. So a normal LV with an ejection systolic murmur radiating even to left coastal second intercostal space can be possible in the setting of an acute MR. And acute MR, people are usually symptomatic than a chronic MR, because the chronic MR, LA is dilated and it is ready to accept the large volume of blood coming from the LV throughout the system. So if you see, understand the murmur of the pathophysiology of MR, what is the management? Management is, the blood is going from the LV to the LA. So what is our endeavor? We want the blood goes from the LV to outer. So preferably what do you do? You should encourage the blood, more blood to go towards the outer. So how do you encourage that? You give peripheral vasodilators, so that you decrease the resistance offered by the aorta to the LV, so that the more blood from the LV goes to the outer. So preferably vasodilators like ACE inhibitors or the hydralazine, they are better given in MR, so that encourages the blood goes towards the outer rather than to the left atrium. So the vasodilators forms the main part of the treatment in the setting of a mitral regurgitation.